Hi, everyone, and welcome to our Exploring English Food and Culture Facebook Live. This Facebook Live is for our free online course, which is on Future Learn and which started this week. I'm joined by Chris, Sally, and Claire. Hi, everyone.
Hello.
Hi.
Educators on the course, and Tina, another educator, will be popping in later to say hello. If you have any questions about the course, about food in the UK, language, anything like that, pop them into the comments. We'll talk about some other topics first to get started. But first, I'm going to go to Chris to ask him to tell us a little bit about this course I've just mentioned. Chris, over to you.
Thank you, Neil. It's a four-week course on the FutureLearn platform, and it's about food and culture in the UK. So we hope that if you join the course, you'll find out a little bit more about what we eat in the UK. You'll find out, you'll do some things to improve your English. You'll talk to people about food, people all over the world, and you'll find out how to cook some typical British dishes. You can watch Neil cooking something this week. Next week, you'll see Tina cooking something. You'll see Sally cooking something. So it's fantastic. We're having such good fun on the course, but that's what it's about. It's about what people in Britain eat and what the traditional idea of British food is about, and lots of other things too.
Okay. And Claire, how's it been going so far in the first week? What's been happening? What have been some of the highlights?
Oh, it's just brilliant. And I'm learning so much about food in other countries. I have to say, I think I'm going to put on some weight during this course because people are sharing recipes. They're sharing photos of their favourite food. We've got a whole wall of breakfasts that show you what people are eating all over the world. So it's just a really lovely place if you want to pick up a new recipe or try a new ingredient.
And any favourites for you, Sally, so far?
Just the enthusiasm, really, on the course. And because there's people from all over the world, which is fantastic. So like from an English teacher's point of view, it's like my dream class because everyone's just so enthusiastic from all over the place and everyone's speaking in English. So it's just amazing. Yeah.
Food's such a great subject. I mean,
as you
can tell, looking at me, I could talk about it all day.
Well, that's the problem that every time I go on the course, I end up feeling hungry.
And same
I go off of my laptop in the kitchen.
We've got, it looks like a busy day. We've got lots of people joining us already. We've got people from Myanmar, from Indonesia, Japan, Tunisia, Russia, Sri Lanka, Tenerife, Brazil, Ukraine, Argentina, Spain. So I guess this, Italy again. So I guess this, you know, confirms what you were saying about people from all over the world. I'm only in the first quarter of the list and we've already covered plenty
of
countries.
Yeah, it's amazing.
Okay, so like I said, any questions that you have about British food, what we eat, recipes, any experiences you've had, any things you like or have tried, just tell us in the comments. But we're going to start with some questions that people have asked on the course already to begin with. So here's the first one from Fatima Gonsalves. Is breakfast in winter the same as breakfast in the summer? So we've been looking at breakfast this week. I mean, Claire, what worked for you? Is breakfast in winter the same as breakfast in summer?
I think most people have breakfast every day, don't they? I do. I have porridge nearly every day. And even when it's boiling outside, I have a nice big bowl of cooked hot porridge in the morning.
I try to have porridge. I usually just end up having a big pot of coffee, occasionally something solid. But yeah.
I was thinking about this because we did used to have, I think we used to have, when I was a child, I think we used to have porridge in winter. It was a winter thing. But then rest of the year, it was just basically cereal or toast. So it wasn't very different, basically, but I always associate porridge with winter.
Mm. Yeah, I have cereal every morning, the same cereal every morning. It's too early in the day to make decisions. so I'll have exactly the same thing every day, a cup of tea, a bowl of cereal. If I'm going for a really long run, then I'll have porridge because I think the porridge gives you more energy. But so if I'm going to go out running, then I'll sometimes have porridge.
What do you have in your porridge, Chris?
Whatever I can find. Usually sweet things, though. I really like honey or cream or things like that. Lots of sugar, lots of energy.
I saw someone on the course put some curry powder in their porridge, which I've never tried. Really? I have put turmeric in it and ginger, but yeah, somebody recommended curry powder.
Okay.
I know some people put salt in, don't they, in the UK? Yeah. Some people have salt.
We always have salt in Scotland in our porridge. Ah. It's not porridge without salt.
You put salt in most things in Scotland, don't you?
That's true. I was going to go to another question, but I'm just saying we've got lots of people still just saying hello from countries from Turkey, India, Luxembourg, Serbia, Mexico, Sudan, Egypt, Palestine, the USA, Nigeria, and lots more. So that's great. So for everyone watching, for anyone who's just joined, we're here to talk about our Exploring English Food and Culture course. So any questions you have about food, we've just been talking about breakfast. You can tell us in the comments what you eat for breakfast as well. Let's move on.
I recognize some of the people from the course in the comments. Claudia there from Brazil is in the comments. Charles is on the course and in the comments. So it's good to see people have come from the course to here.
In fact, just to follow up with a live question straight away, because it follows on from this question from Miss Sukma. Do British people have a specific habit to have morning tea or morning coffee? That's an interesting question. When I was growing up, it was always tea, but now it's always coffee for me in the morning. I don't know, what do you think? Chris, tea or coffee in the morning for you?
It's tea for me. I don't start drinking coffee until about 10 o'clock in the morning, but the first hot drink of the day is a cup of tea.
Claire?
Same. Black tea.
Same. I'm the same as you, Claire. I have black tea, and then I take the dog for a walk, and then I have a coffee in that order.
Looks like I'm the outlier, then. I start the day with a big cafetiere of an 8-cup cafetiere of coffee. For me.
Well, I want to get, you know, those machines you get, teas made, that you can put by the side of the bed. So it's like an alarm clock and a tea maker in the same machine. So you wake up to a cup of tea ready made at your bedside.
Yeah,
that's what my mum used to do when I was a kid. Every morning of my childhood, she would wake me up with a cup of tea until I left to go to uni.
Oh, that's nice.
That's nice, yeah.
Okay, let's move on to another question from Magda. I've noticed that we have lots of teachers on the course already, and Mag is just saying, is there a chance we could get any lesson plans or other teaching materials out of this course? Who would like to say a few words about that to Magda?
I can if you want. Shall I go?
Yeah, go on.
Yeah.
Well, what I was going to say was you could definitely use the course with your students, and I know teachers have done that before. So one thing you could do is if they're adults, you could get students, or if they're over 13, you could get them to join the course. And then if you follow them, you can get their profile link from them, and then you can follow them and you can all see what each other are doing on the course. So you could recommend that they do week two, for example, and do an activity from week two, and then you could have a look at their comments, something like that. You could use some of the videos in a class if you didn't want to join the course, and you could do a typical lesson based on a video with a sort of pre-viewing task, etc. But we've also got, I'm going on a bit, we've also got lots of food lessons on the Teaching English website, which are fantastic, and we could put a link to those.
Yeah, we've got some videos on Learn English Teams as well, haven't we? And I was thinking about the quizzes in the course as well, like why not use one of those in your class? With your students, or we've also got teachers talking about doing cooking with their students, so maybe that works too. I think, in fact, Magda is involved in that conversation, so why not get your students, you know, do a CLIL lesson and students learn to cook as well and learning English at the same time.
I've done that. I'll tell you about this some other time, maybe later today, but you know, I actually once with a class of mine, I actually did deep fried Mars bars. You know, the less said about health and safety, the better. But it was a fantastic lesson.
but the other thing, Magda, is that if you have lesson plans, or if any of the other teachers on the course have lesson plans, then the course is a place you can share them. Mm. You know, so if you give us your lesson plans or other teachers give us your lesson plans, we can collect them and find a place to share them for you, or you can just talk to other teachers on the course.
I wonder if maybe it's worth setting up another Padlet for that, perhaps, because the Padlets are going so well. Mm-hmm. And that's an idea. Mm-hmm. We could talk about that. Okay. Just a confirmation from Claudia Yuzviak here, who's just saying, in my experience, breakfast is the meal that people vary the least. And I think,
I agree.
You've all proved that to be true. And Anna Guerra, a bit like Chris with his too early to make choice, says, easy to eat, don't like cooking in the morning. That's it. Get out of the way.
Okay. Yeah. Cool.
Uh-huh. And just another comment here from May-Ann and Kiso Aquino, who's saying, in the Philippines, we used to eat porridge for breakfast, especially in the rainy season. Okay. Let's move on to another question. From David Lewis. What's the best dish you can cook? Okay. So we have everyone's cooking on the course in different videos, except for Chris. Yeah. So we see lots of things in there. But what's the best dish? The best dish that you can cook. Who wants to start? Claire, let's begin with you.
I think really I'm more of a baker than a cook, so I like making cakes. I would say my best cake is lemon drizzle, and I've already shared that recipe that on the Padlet. I love that. But my best dish is a vegetarian, in fact, it's vegan, Sri Lankan coconut curry.
Mm.
I've been cooking that for years, and I'm fine tuning it with my spices, and I think I've got it. I've got it down now.
That sounds good. Okay, Sally.
That sounds amazing. When you just said lemon drizzle cake, actually made my mouth water. okay, so I think, well, the thing that I like making and the thing that people tell me that's really nice that I make is actually vegetarian lasagna, which is not a sort of typical British dish, I guess. But somebody showed me how to make it years and years ago, and I think, like you, Claire, I've been fine-tuning it for years. It's got loads of cheese in it. It's really nice.
Hmm. Okay. Chris?
Well, I can cook about five things, and that just, you know, I don't have a big range, but each of those things is perfect. I mean, people still talk about my toad in the hole years later. I like cooking sausages with mashed potato and onion gravy.
I mean, bangers and mash.
It's really easy to make, but it seems to use every utensil in the kitchen. And you know, the rule in our house is that the person who cooks doesn't do the washing up. So it's better to be the cook than the washer up on that day.
Mine is probably soup. None of them are British. So, I mean, although I do cook lots of Scottish soups, I guess my best one, I think, is tomato, chili, and coriander soup. I learned to cook that in Cambodia, of all places, and it's just, I never get tired of it. I could eat it every day like you do with porridge.
It's true. You've made soup for me, and it was very good, so I can agree that you make excellent soup.
It must be a Scottish winter thing or something. It's all warming soups.
You mentioned toad in the hole, Chris, and just to say on the course, there's a bit of a debate about toad in the hole as to whether it is delicious or not delicious at all. So people have tried it. People have come to Britain and tried it. Some people liked it. Some people didn't.
What's the kind of majority kind of at the moment?
I don't know. It's hanging in the balance, I think. So anyone who doesn't know what it is, Chris, what is it?
If they didn't like it, they've not had a good one. If it's a bad one, then it's kind of wet and soggy and not good. But if it's done correctly, then it's excellent. And in fact, isn't Sally going to tell us how to cook Yorkshire pudding? Because that's the secret.
Can do. But I want to know. I wondered if you were going to ask Tina what's the best dish she can cook.
Good question. Let me see if she is in place. Okay, I'm going to remove Chris temporarily and bring Tina in. Tina, hello. Say hello to everyone.
Hello. Oh, I'm so excited. I love cooking, and I've got a reputation for.
Okay.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Can hear you fine. Yeah.
It's roast dinner or Christmas dinner. And I do all that now. Honestly, I do so much that we've got like 3 days worth of food. I do the stuffings, I do nut roast, I do duck, all on one day. It's just amazing.
So for your regular like Sunday roast dinner or something, not Christmas dinner, what do you go for? Is it beef? Is it chicken? What's your favorite?
I live in Italy at the moment, so it's very often it's either roast chicken or roast pork. Because beef isn't so popular here where I live. And lamb is really special occasions here. So it's like Easter and things like that. So you have to order that very often. So it's probably roast chicken to please everyone, but I love roast pork and crackling. Oh my goodness. It's quite exciting because I've just my mouth's watering a bit.
Talking about
roast chicken, it's got to have the trimming still, hasn't it? Like sage and onion stuffing.
I was just going to say, talking about mouthwatering, I want to know what country they're actually from, because breakfast is quite complex in my country. It looks like the main course menu of luxury restaurants. I want that breakfast. Where are you from? Tell us in the comments, because we can't see from the profile, so let us know. Okay, let's move on. Lots of questions coming in already. Lots of comments rather than questions. Like we said, everyone loves to talk about food. There's great stuff here. This is my favorite one so far from Luigi Trezzi, though, who says, the best dish is haggis with turnip puree. Oh, absolutely. Nice. Absolutely. Wow. I mean, that's never a truer word spoken. I don't know. What do you think?
I've never had haggis, but I'm vegetarian, so I think I will die without having eaten it.
Our vegetarian haggis is fantastic, too.
Yeah, I have vegetarian haggis.
But what's in it? What's in a vegetarian haggis?
Lots of nuts and pulses and lots of things, you know, it's good, and lots of spices. It's really tasty. I do actually make one every year. Okay, lots of people sharing their best dishes from different countries. Okay, question from Mayan and Kiso Aquino here in general. This is about rice. I mean, do people in the UK eat rice often with their main dishes? What would you say to this?
Yeah, if they're making a curry, yeah, definitely. But I'd say, I think people buy more potatoes than rice and have potato variations in the UK, wouldn't you say?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think so.
I'm going to pop out for a moment and bring Chris back in because potatoes are his specialist subject.
He is good on potatoes, isn't he?
Yeah, it's absolutely.
But don't you think a lot of younger people, like uni students and that, eat rice and pasta more than potatoes? Yeah. A lot easier to do. I know my kids do.
Instant rice as well, though you just take the lid off and microwave it.
Yeah.
Yeah, pasta definitely is what my kids eat. And I think they would find a potato too difficult.
I hope they're not watching.
What do you know about potatoes, though, Chris? Neil just said you're a potato expert.
Well,
have you got one there?
What do I have? Probably. I'm never very far away from a potato, but my box of vegetables just arrived. So
what you got?
What's in it this week?
I've got just new potatoes. The lovely small.
Oh, they look good.
I like them. Lovely with butter.
Put in the jacket with a little bit of butter.
Mint. Yeah.
Some lovely spring onions. An aubergine. And much more, but you don't want to see everything that's in my veg box.
And do you get that every week then?
Yeah, well, actually, we talk about this in the course next week on week two. We talk about people having vegetable deliveries like this. So all of these vegetables are grown very close to here, so they haven't traveled very far, and they're all things that are in season, so you know they're all locally grown. And it means you don't have to worry about it. I like it this way around, because you get the vegetables and then you decide what to cook. You don't have to think of what you want to cook and then go and buy the vegetables. The food that you have decides what you're eating.
It's like a game show. You get the vegetables and you have to make a dish from it.
It's exactly like that.
Speaking about game shows, I'm going to have to kick somebody else out so I can pop back in for a moment. So it's going to be like Wheel of Fortune or something. I'm just going to go around and kick all of you out individually at different times, okay? This time it's going to be Claire's turn.
Absolute power.
Because the next question, we can still hear you though, Claire, so you can still join in. Just the question from Gordana Bielajac-Vujasinovic, which is the most popular tea in the UK? That's a good question. And I'm not sure if we'll all agree on this. Chris is never far from a potato, and obviously Tina's never far from a big bag of tea. I just went shopping last week. I actually crossed the border and went to another country with my COVID certificate just so I could get tea, because it's really hard for me to get this here. I vote for Earl Grey.
I love Earl Grey as well.
So I two votes for Earl Grey.
I like Earl Grey, but in the afternoon, not a morning tea.
Yes, I mean
proper tea in the morning and then Earl Grey in the afternoon. It's a bit lighter.
Well, I'm having the morning, like a good strong cup of builder's tea. Yes.
No.
Then what would you have in the morning, tea, Tina?
Milky tea, no sugar. Tea. Yeah, I like it. So it's strong tea, but then lots of milk in it. So it's
okay. No milk for me. But definitely, I think black tea. People drink more black tea than anything else.
Yeah, but with milk.
No.
Well, I don't have milk in tea. It's too. It's yuck with milk.
Yeah, I don't like it.
Yeah, but you're cosmopolitan. I mean, I think ordinary people like me drink black tea with milk in.
Maybe.
Oh, I thought you were saying I'm ordinary as well, Chris. Then.
I always have milk in my tea. I'm surprised by the rest of you. I mean, when I travel, I have milk. I have tea without milk. But at home, always milk in my tea.
Yeah. No?
I even take tea bags when I go and stay in a place like a hotel. So when I went to Rome this weekend, I took tea bags and then I went to a supermarket and snuck in a little sort of carton of milk and stuck it in the fridge so that I could wake up and have a cup of tea in the morning.
I take tea bags too. And I take something that's just been mentioned in the comments.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, mama.
I take this with me when I travel so that I can have it on my toast.
Okay, so we've moved on from the most popular tea in the UK to Marmite, love it or hate it.
But the people, okay, we have the question. Do we need to explain what Marmite is first?
Yes.
For people who don't know. Claire, what is it?
Well, I believe it was first discovered as a byproduct of the brewing industry, because it's something that comes from yeast. And it's something that was found at the bottom of the vat when they were brewing beer. I'm not sure if this is right or not. But you can see it's this kind of very dark, gloopy, sticky deliciousness, and it's salty, and you spread it on toast. Oh, and do you know what?
A salty yeast spread. Doesn't that just sound appetizing and
delicious? Amazing. Love it.
I'm very much on the hate it end of the spectrum there. I hate it. I show me some Marmite and something and I'll run a mile. I guess Claire and Sally are definitely obviously pro Marmite. Chris was shaking his head. Tina?
Well, go on, Tina, sorry.
I actually really love Marmite, but only every now and then. Every now and then when I need a bit of salt, I have to have a proper bit of toast with lots of butter and lots of Marmite on and eat that. Normally on a Sunday morning or something, but that'd be a bacon butty. But yeah, otherwise it's when I need a bit of salt really. Using gravy.
Small comment for Tina. Can't argue with that.
that's just for today, for Tina.
And this kind of follows on from what we were saying about the tea. Is it true that British people prefer drinking tea with milk and they don't understand people who add lemon in tea? I don't know about don't understand, but Chris, you would say most people drink tea with milk, wouldn't you say?
Most people, I think, drink tea with milk. I do. And in fact, I wanted to say, because in the comments, Donna Dogliano has rightly said that the best tea is Yorkshire tea, which is what I drink. So, yeah, I think tea with milk is still probably the most common way to drink tea in the UK.
Okay. Hold on a second. as you can tell already from the tea and the Marmite conversations, food is obviously a very a passionate subject where people have very strong opinions. On the course, what are some of the things we talk about that, about variations and regional variations and things like that, and people, what people like and don't like? I mean, can you tell us a little, for people who have maybe just joined us, explain a little bit more about what we actually look at in the course as well? As
well, that. We're later in the course. So this week in the course, we talked about what people have for breakfast. And in fact, what we haven't mentioned here so far is the full English breakfast, which is a huge meal first thing in the morning. Which is the traditional breakfast that most people don't eat very often. But later in the course, we do talk about regional variations. We talk about food from the four different countries in the UK, so England and in Northern Ireland and Scotland and Wales. And even for different parts of England, there are different regional specialities as well that we mention. We talk about vegetarianism and veganism and how that's become a growing trend over the last few years. We talk about shopping, where people shop, how people shop. Claire, what else do we talk about? Restaurants we talk about?
I was just thinking about, in terms of regional variation, we sometimes mention words that are different in different parts of the country, like baked goods that Sally makes in her video, scones or scones. We say them both in the UK, and again, everyone has their opinion what's right, but also different words for our meals of the day depending on which part of the UK that you're in. So that's quite interesting, I think. And I also want to know about other countries, if you all call your meals the same word or if it's a different word for your midday meal or your evening meal.
You mentioned, although we can't see Sally at the moment, we can still hear her. So, you know, I mean, we may hear her very strange pronunciation of scones pop up at any moment. And
what means scones?
No, scones.
Scones.
So we talk about that. That's in week three, is it? We talk about different ways of saying things. The other thing that Claire just said that I think is really important is the thing that's making the course so much fun is hearing opinions and recipes and hearing about food from all over the world. That's what makes it great for me. So if you're on the course, then keep doing that. If you're not on the course, come and join the course and tell us about what you eat for breakfast in your country.
I have so many great comments popping up just now. I'm just going to pop up a few for a moment. One from Anna Guerra, who's saying, going back to Chris's famous potatoes, your potatoes are different from the ones we have in Brazil. That's interesting. It'd be good to know, because, I mean, we have lots of different types of potatoes, of course, but, I mean, maybe we have these Padlets where you can share pictures of food. It'd be nice to kind of see maybe some things like that, some different varieties of stuff that pops up there.
Well, we get different varieties of potato in the UK. I mean, you get floury potatoes and more starchy things. The ones I have here are the very small new potatoes.
Okay, and another, just before I bring Sally back in, okay, hold it. I'm getting so many interesting comments. I'm just reading through them and thinking, "Well, that's interesting."
What about crisps? Surely, crisp butties? No,
I know. Yeah, crisp sandwiches.
That's in week two.
Oh,
okay. but this is an interesting question, and I brought this one up because it's one that we've, among ourselves, among the educators in the course, we've been speaking about that this week already, about, you know, meal times and where you eat your meal, what you do during your meal and stuff like that. So I'm just going to throw this question out, then disappear for all of you to talk about it. Cassia Bialik saying, what are the cultural traditions associated with your meals? Do you talk a lot during the meal? Do you drink? I mean, I guess wine, beer or something like that within that or not? Where do you eat is a question that Cassia doesn't ask, but I'm asking. So let's talk about that a bit, and I'll bring Sally back in. Okay.
Well, this is week four, isn't it? We mentioned this on the course in week four. You hear people talking about where they eat their meals and eating together as a family and that sort of cultural tradition. So if you want the full answer, then go to the course and look at week four. But I don't know, how about you lot? Do you eat meals together with the family?
In the evening, my dinner, the evening meal, I would eat with the family. And we always did that as kids, and I still do that now. I have it with my husband every night. And for me, that's like the catch up. How is your day? Talk about things. And I like it to last, and I like chatting over the evening meal. But I know not everyone does that, do they?
We do that, definitely do it the weekend. And we quite often have on Saturday and Sunday, it'd probably be the midday meal normally, or sometimes the evening meal. We'll have it at the table together and we'll all chat. But you know what we do quite a lot, and I don't know if I'm going to be criticised for this, is that we we sit on the sofa and have our dinner eating the while we're watching the TV.
Nothing wrong with that, especially when the football's on.
I've just admitted that.
Tina, you have a comment?
No, not at all. I totally agree that there's certain days that we do that. But when the kids were younger, we always sat at the dinner table an evening. It was the four of us. There were the two kids left home now. But yes, we always sat at the table, and it was a time to catch up. It was a time to sort of forget about work and find out what the kids had done, what we were going to do, where we were going, what family members were doing, things around the world. Live in the UK to me it's really, really important, because it is in fact one of the only times you actually all sort of sit down and have to talk. Very often you're passing, don't necessarily, you're passing up the stairs or something, so you don't necessarily talk. So I think it is quite important, and especially on a Sunday. We always had roast dinner when I was young, and I always did it with my kids. Even on the hottest days we used to have it. So yeah,
I just remember one interesting thing that I was once having a meal with a friend of mine who was from Slovakia, and there were three or four British people, and we started eating, and my Slovak friend said, "It's true, you don't say anything before you start eating." Because in Slovak culture it would be traditional to say, dobro hut in Slovak, but bon appetit in French, or just to say something to indicate that you're about to start eating. And in Britain, we don't do that.
Tuck in.
But I know, but there's not the phrase, is there? Like, it's not like everybody says, okay, like you say it and then.
Yeah.
I agree. And I didn't really know that until I sort of had friends from different countries and I traveled and I learned another language. And now I think it's weird that we don't have that in the UK. It's a nice thing to do,
Yeah.
Yeah.
Cassia has got a follow-up to the question with some more information and things about that, where Cassia is saying French people speak a lot at the table. They drink wine and aperitif very slowly. Polish people eat a small dinner in the evening. If we throw a party in the evening, we don't cook warm dishes.
That's a good idea.
That's interesting.
Okay. One thing that I should mention is we've had dozens and dozens of people. Fish and chips is clearly a winner. Lots of people saying that they like fish and chips. Lots of people saying they've tried fish and chips and they love that. We do talk about fish and chips on the course, don't we?
We do. Week three.
We do. We talk about the history of fish and chips, where it came from. Mm-hmm. Did you know fish and chips is mentioned in Charles Dickens novels? That's my fact about fish and chips.
I didn't know that.
I mean, to be completely honest, I don't like fish, especially. So, I mean, I quite often will go to the fish and chip shop, but it won't be fish that I get with my chips. It will be something else, a pie, probably. So, I really love the chips that come from a fish and chip shop.
Haggis and chips. Haggis and batter with chips. Best thing in the world. Better than fish and chips. Much as I love fish and chips. Okay,
you know what we should say about fish and chips, and because it's been a theme of the first week as well, is how much of British food, and especially popular food in Britain, has been brought by immigration. So both the idea of frying potatoes to make chips and also frying up fish were brought by immigrants to the UK. So our national dish is thanks to other people coming. So that's something that we talk about a lot this week, isn't it, with your chicken tikka masala, Neil?
Yeah. Uh-huh, definitely. Like the language, our food is a mixture of so many different influences. We started a sub-conversation here on potatoes. Manuel Gordillo is saying the potatoes we eat in Canary come from the UK called King Edward, a big potato.
King Edward, I absolutely approve. Manuel, King Edward is a great potato.
I'm a Maris Piper man myself. I don't know.
Nice.
Okay, let's move on to another question. Now, we have some questions about some, you know, we mentioned regional foods and things earlier, but we have some questions about some specific dishes. From Mary Alice Hogg O'Rourke, I'd like to know if anyone has a good recipe for Yorkshire pudding. I've tried to cook Yorkshire pudding maybe 5 or 6 times in my life, and it's never been great. So do one of you have a good recipe for this? Sally?
Yeah. Can I talk about, because, okay, so this is the meal that I was talking about where we sit down and have, we eat together as a family, features Yorkshire pudding, and my family absolutely love Yorkshire pudding. So I think we've got a link we can put in to it for a recipe, but the ingredients are basically eggs, flour, milk, a bit of salt and pepper. And I knew you were going to ask me this question, so I've got some props. And this is, so this is my
Yorkshire pudding.
Hey? You got a bun tray?
Yeah, I've got a bun tray.
Yorkshire puddings, yeah.
So that's what I put my... So when you put this in the oven and heat it up for about really, really hot for about 10 minutes with some vegetable oil. I use olive oil in the compartments. So the oil has to be really, really hot. So that's the trick, Neil. The oil has to be really hot. And then when you've whisked it up, pour it into a jug and then pour it in when the oil's really hot. And you can do it really quickly because it's in a jug, and then you get it straight in the oven.
Okay.
And leave it there. Don't open the oven until it's cooked. 15 minutes until it's all fluffy and golden.
What temperature?
Hot. Okay. Hot. Probably, I don't know, 220, 230, or whatever. As hot as it'll go.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And your Yorkshire puddings will be delicious with gravy poured all over them. Really, really nice.
I do love Yorkshire puddings. Like I say, I've just never managed to cook a good one, but okay, I'll try again. Next question is, can you please, from Terry Atildo, can you please tell me about parkin? Maybe a short history and how typical it is, if possible. I don't know parkin, so yes. So Claire, I think you were going to talk about this.
So parkin brings back a lot of happy memories for me because we used to have it on the 5th of November on bonfire night. Which is a night in the UK that we celebrate by lighting fires and fireworks and also having special food. And it's a really heavy, thick, gingery cake. It's got oats in it. It's got treacle, which is a kind of molasses, and golden syrup. And when I say heavy, I mean if you pick up a parkin, it's cake. It's literally like a brick. So it was quite a wintry dish. Now I tried to find out where it came from, and it's Yorkshire. I thought it was Lancashire, so it's from the north of England, but also from the 19th century, and using oats was quite a big part of the diet then, so a natural thing to do was to put it into cakes, so you have this stodgy, delicious filling cake.
Can I just say, I mean, so far, maybe it's just me, you know, coming from Scotland, I don't know, but so far we've had a salty yeast spread that you find at the bottom of a beer barrel and a stodgy heavy cake like a brick. I'm not sure these are advertised.
Sorry, lemon drizzle cake. Mentioned is very light, fluffy, fragrant.
It's delicious. Parkin's delicious. You've never tried it, Neil.
Never tried it.
It's really delicious.
But we've talked about this on the course as well. The UK is a cold northern climate, and in you know that kind of climate, then you need that food that will give you lots of energy, keep you warm, keep you going. So, parkin, and you should know that. I mean, you're from Scotland. Yeah, so
we have our own cakes, or you know, our black buns and things like that. But yeah, parkin has passed me by so far.
I'm sure I can find one here in the UK, so I'll find one and put a picture on the course somewhere.
Okay. I think we've been here for 40 minutes now, so I think we've kind of run out of time. From this. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go around and give everyone a chance for some final words. I'm going to bring Tina. Yes. No, Tina. I'm looking at Tina's screen at the moment, but she's vanished from it. There's only an empty chair there. So I'm not going to start with Tina. I'm going to give Tina a chance to come back. I'm going to start with Sally. Just any final message to the people watching.
Thanks for joining us. Thanks for all your questions. It's fantastic. We really like talking about food, and we'd love you to come and join on the course, join in on the course and talk about food some more.
Okay. Yep, no question. We like talking about food. We've barely started. We could be here for another 2 hours. Chris?
The same, really. This, what Sally said. The, you know, it, if you haven't joined the course, then please do join the course. And at the start of the course, you'll hear Claire saying that, you know, we believe talking about food brings people together. And it really does. The conversation on the course is so great. My only concern is that I'm just going to get fatter and fatter over this course.
Okay. And sorry, I'm going to disappear for a moment and pop Tina back in. Yay! Tina.
I'm sorry, but we just didn't talk about crisps. And there's even a, you know, a question in the
there is a question. Yeah, there is a question. Someone asks, what's the favorite flavor of crisps or the most popular?
I know, and we didn't answer.
Well, we can quickly do this before you make your comment. I think salt and vinegar. What do you think? No?
No.
Yeah, cheese and onion. Salt and vinegar.
Oops. Prawn cocktail. No.
Okay. Definitely one of these.
Cheese and onion.
Okay. So, Tina, your last message for the people watching.
For everyone watching, thanks so much for joining us today. Hasn't it been exciting? I love it. Do come and join us on the call.
Okay, and you've awesome. Broken up a little bit.
So I want to see you on there and hear your delicious food.
Okay, sorry, I you broke up a little bit there, so I interrupted you. But no, Claire, last words.
This course is so great, especially now because most of us can't travel, and this is one way that we can, you know, learn a bit more about the world and different countries is by sharing recipes and sharing food and trying something new. So join in and try a new dish.
Okay. And that's it for today. I'm not going to bring myself back on the screen for the last part, so I'm just a voice. but the links for joining the course are in the post here. And of course, we've got lots of posts that we share every day about the course, about food, about all the things we talk about. So as everyone said, if you haven't joined the course yet, make sure that you join it now. It's free, it's fun, it's fantastic. And, you know, we're having a great time, and I think everyone on the course is having a great time. So that's it. Shall we say goodbye?
Yeah. Thanks, everyone. Bye.
Bye. Bye-bye.